right.
Wow, that was a really weak clap, man. All right. Well, hey, everybody, it's Grim Green from GrimGreen.com back here today. Thank you so much for joining me again here on the Tuesday Bro Tuesday. We're going to be talking about a whole mess of stuff. We got some news here at the top of the program. We're going to do some vape stuff. We got a new RDA joining us this week. We got two things leaving, one thing staying. Ooh, I like to be so cryptic with my vape stuff. Of course, we're going to have some getting to know Grim Green as well as viewer mail, and we're going to wrap it all up at the end with a random juice tasting of a juice that literally just arrived in the mail a few days ago. I don't know at all who it came from, just showed up. So I figured, you know what? Fuck it. Let's vape it. So the first bit of news that I want to talk about is I am moving. Yes, again. I announced this on the Culture Clouds podcast last week, but I am moving. It doesn't matter really the reason. The reason is this apartment is becoming far too expensive for me for what I have. So I'm going to move roughly 5 miles into another neighborhood here in San Diego, and it's going to be just fantastic. But the reason that I'm saying this is because in conjunction with going to Las Vegas at the end of January, moving, and then flying out to the Outer Banks to watch the Super Bowl at the beginning of February, it might affect my video schedule. So what I'm going to do to kind of make up for that is I am going to have a couple normal reviews. The Tuesday Bro Tuesday and the vlog programs are going to be a little bit few and far between, but what I'm going to do in the meantime to make up for that lost, you know, that lost content is I'm going to have some reviews. I'm going to knock out some freaking reviews. I've got a bunch of products that I'm actually really excited about, and there's going to be reviews. There's going to be reviews. So there might not be regular Tuesday Bro Tuesdays. There might not... Why am I burping? There might not be regular vlogs, but there is going to be a whole mess of reviews thrown in there, getting published while I'm traveling, while I'm moving, and I'm gonna have a very, very, very dope ass new office coming very, very soon. And did anybody notice? I completely finally redid this whole back wall. It looks so much nicer, so much cleaner, just all spaced and good and frames. I'm gonna recreate this, and I got the Stormtrooper here. I'm gonna recreate this, hopefully right behind me in my new office. I may even get another Han Solo cabinet to maybe put on the other side. Anyway, that's just really a personal update. Yeah, I'm gonna be moving, and it's a thing that is going to affect my videos. I do have some actual news though. Did anybody know that you can use your iPad as an external monitor? This is great. This changes the way I shoot videos. I put my camera right in front of my monitor, so I'm constantly like going like this and like looking or like reading from over here and then like moving and like reading from over here. Now I can just drag those windows right onto my iPad and I can read them, and it's amazing. So Azeem Chowdhury. Does anybody remember Azeem? Right to be smoke-free lawsuit, lawyer for Keller and Heckman. They're suing the FDA right now. Well, Azeem hit me up and said, "Hey Nick, I hope you've been well. I was wondering if you would be able to plug our upcoming vapor law symposium on your show. Details are below. It's going to be the most comprehensive legal seminar ever produced with respect to vapor products. A great way for small businesses in this industry to get a good understanding of the legal requirements. Seriously, check out the massive agenda. Also, the majority of the proceeds from this event are going to fund our FDA and Indiana lawsuits on behalf of the Right to Be Smoke-Free Coalition. This will be a great way for companies to learn about the law, help save their businesses, and chip in on some advocacy efforts. It's win-win. Of course, I'd be happy to do a short segment on your show to discuss the symposium if you are interested. Also, please don't hesitate to pass the below information along to anyone you think would be interested in attending. Have any questions or comments? Let me know. Thanks for your help, Azeem." So he forwarded me, yeah, Vape Mentors and Keller and Heckman are putting together an e-vapor law symposium. Is your e-liquid ready for the FDA? This is happening in Washington, D.C., February 2nd and 3rd, 2017. If you are a liquid manufacturer, a small business owner in the vapor industry, I highly, highly suggest going to this. Azeem is incredibly smart. He's just an incredibly smart lawyer of Keller and Heckman, who, like I said, are part of the lawsuit suing the FDA as well as taking legal action in Indiana. Some of the things on the agenda are an e-liquid PMTA science panel with guest speaker Carndo from ChemRisk, Enthalpy Analytical and Global Laboratory Services. Good Lord, you have a long title. Step-by-step guidance using the FDA's e-submitter and the CTP portal to submit ingredient listing reports, health documents, and other FDA submissions. State law and tax updates by Paul Blair from the Americans for Tax Reform. Understanding the UK MHRA approval process for medicinal nicotine products by Dr. Paul Marshall, regulatory specialist at Nerudia, and legal implications of using cannabinoid CBD in e-liquids. There's a link to the full agenda, and there's a link, I'm going to put a link down in the description, where you, if you are a business owner or you know someone who is a business owner, get them this link, get them to sign up. It's happening, wait, let me double check the dates, February 2nd and 3rd, 2017 in Washington, D.C. Like I said, I'll post a link down in the description where you can sign up for this symposium. I think it's fantastic. I think it's going to be awesome. And thank you, Azeem, for sending that my way. I do have one other news thing to talk about. Man, having the iPad right here is just fantastic. I do have one more thing to talk about. States. Okay, so this comes from IBJ. This is the Indianapolis Business Journal, IBJ.com. The state's dubious vaping law to get a big overhaul. And we're talking about Indiana right now, folks. Indiana's vaping industry could be upended again as lawmakers tackle changes to a law that has been roundly criticized as unfair and even corrupt. Yeah. Corrupt, you think? State Senator Randy Head, Republican from Longsport, said he will file a bill next week to stop the monopoly that was created by legislation passed in 2015 and amended in 2016, which essentially put one private security firm in charge of deciding which firms could manufacture the juice used in e-cigarettes sold in Indiana. If you're not up to date with everything that's happening in Indiana, get up to date with everything that's happening in Indiana. It is super shady. It's something that a lot of people, including myself, have been, we've been talking about it and giving updates on Indiana for what seems like months now. His bill would likely squash the requirement that barred new manufacturers from entering the industry in Indiana after July 2016. We want common sense regulations like safety caps and understanding what the ingredients are, Head said. But if I want to go into business, I can't prove I'm the safest on earth. But if I want to go into that business and I can prove I'm the safest on earth, I'm not allowed to go into that business now. That just doesn't make sense. This is a wicked long article that I'm not going to read the whole thing, but I will post a link down to it in the description. He goes on to say, we want reasonable common sense regulation in place of the monopolistic regulations in place now. That's it. That's good. That's amazing. I mean, that's what we want. That's what we all want. We want reasonable, common sense regulations when it comes to vaping. And thankfully, it's moving that way in Indiana, although it wasn't always moving that way in Indiana. So yeah, that's what I got for news right now. Let's wrap that up. Let's jump into some vape stuff. All right, so last week the dude RDA left the queue, and what RDA we have joining us this week is the Sapor version 2. Now, this is something that arrived a while ago. I put a build on it, I vaped it for like a day or so, and then I went, I'm just gonna put you to the side. You're gonna wait for Tuesday, Bro Tuesday. I don't wanna vape you until you get to Tuesday, Bro Tuesday. The Sapor version 2 has a nice velocity style deck. I did a 22 gauge. Anarchist Nichrome. Now people always think I'm saying Nichrome, but I'm not. I say Nichrome. Nichrome. It sounds like it. I promise you, I know how to say it correctly. It's Nichrome. I'm using 22 gauge Anarchist Nichrome wire. I did a, looks like about a 10 wrap around a 3.5 millimeter. Came out to 0.27 ohms, which is great. I'm running it on the Boss Genesis DNA 200. The interesting thing about the Sapor version 2 is the airflow. It's got It's got some wacky ass airflow going on, man. It's basically got everything but bottom airflow. It's got side airflow. There's five holes right there that you can adjust with this little guy right here. And then it's got top down airflow. And that works in conjunction with the cap. It goes in and then down at your coils like the original Sapore RDA did. So what I want to do is I want to close off that side airflow and I want to just use the top down because it goes in and then points it like directly down at your coils. So I'm gonna juice this up. I got some juice that I got in Paris from Dinner Lady. It's a rice pudding, which I was going through my juices. This just sounded good-ish. And I remember tasting it in Paris and thinking, yeah, that's pretty good. That's not bad. So I ended up taking a bottle of it home with me. So I'm gonna run this 0.27 ohm dual coil build at about 70 watts. Yeah, that seems reasonable to me. And then what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna line up those top airflows directly over the coils, directly over the coils. Yeah, see, that looks awesome. When you push this cap down on there, the directional airflow things actually go like right at the coils. There's maybe 2 or 3 millimeters space and those airflow things are right there at the coils. So far, all of the O-rings on this have been really on point. It's got a double O-ring on the bottom. It snaps down really hard. Even the O-ring on the drip tip really fits in there really well and holds, I mean, really super snug and nice. But yeah, it's all juiced up. Let's give it a first toot. That's good airflow. Using just the top airflow, it's a bit of a restricted lung hit. It's not as like wide open, smooth, swooshy as I would like, but it's nice. I oftentimes really enjoy those restricted lung hits. And because I'm just using the top airflow, you can blow your juice in there like a boss. The coils I built are nice and big and they're up against the post. So when I blow my juice through the middle, even on this Velocity style deck, it gets juice everywhere where it needs to go. And because the airflow is set up so high, it's not going to leak unless I tip it over. But even then, I don't think it would leak. I really like the feel of that restricted lung hit quite a bit. You can also turn off the top airflow by rotating it and then turn on the side airflow. And this is full open. It's airflow directly at your coils. I have a feeling it's just going to be like a typical Clouds Bro Clouds RDA. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that right there, that's a fucking really good vape. There's nothing super innovative about this RDA. It's a Velocity style deck with side airflow, or a Velocity style deck with top down airflow, or a Velocity style deck with both top down and side airflow. What? Yeah, you can do that too. So I'm going to open up the top airflow all the way, and I'm going to close down the side airflow about halfway. We're going to leave two little holes open, and that makes for a very, very open, cloud chasey, swooshy, swooshy vape. And if I open these up all the way, there's like no, barely any resistance at all. Just clouds. I can tell that the flavor has gone down a little bit, but it's still good. What if I left this at just one hole open on the side, and then top airflow down? I think that's going to be the sweet spot right there. This top airflow is really quite nice. It's a restricted lung hit. It feels good. It feels like you're getting a nice saturated vape on it. So clicking over to watofo.com, it comes in black and stainless steel, $40. Sure, $40. All right, well, I'm going to spend about a week or two with this Sapore RDA. I'm going to try out a bunch of different airflow configurations. I'm really kind of sketchy on this middle airflow adjustment. It just seems to move really super freely. I don't know if it's going to stay in place. Like if I find my sweet spot where it's like, I want the top airflow, and then I want two holes on the middle airflow. I want to see if it's actually going to stay there during use and when I'm handling it, when I'm like putting it in and out of my pocket, see if those actually stay in place. Right now, I can say that just the top airflow open, dude, it's a really nice, flavorful vape. So yeah, welcome, Sapor. Welcome, Sapor version, what? Version 2 to the queue. So now we're on to this guy, the RDTA box. I still hate the way this stupid thing looks. Battery compartment comes out, batteries go in there, battery compartment slides up, covers up the batteries. It's got a big, ugly, but clicky button, and it's got a nice little display right there where you can see your voltage, your wattage, your resistance, how many puffs you've taken, and a little battery meter. It's got a really super easy to use menu. Three clicks will get you into the menu. You can choose between nickel, titanium, stainless steel, or wattage mode. You can set it to normal, soft, and hard as like a preheat or a user enabled, set your own preheat on there. I have it set to normal. I have it set to 85 watts. I've strictly been using this in wattage mode because I've been running fused Claptons on there. It's really super easy to build. It's a Velocity style deck, really super easy to wick. You just put your wicks down just barely into the little tank there. This is a gigantic 12 mil tank in there. I did clean it out, and I'm going to tell you how I cleaned it out. I was careful not to run any water through it because I had a feeling that if I start running water through here, I mean, this battery door isn't protected by any sort of O-rings. It's not like water resistant or water tight in here, and I really did not want water getting down into the battery area. So what I did is I took off the deck, I took off the little fill hole right there, and I carefully filled it with water. Very carefully filled it with water. And then I put my palm over the whole thing, covering up both holes, and like gave it a little bit of a shake around. Be sure to cover both everything on there. Keep in mind the deck is off, the fill hole is off. Put your palm on there and just shake it all around and then quickly dump it back out. And then I took a moist paper towel, and this, when you take this deck off, it's a big open hole there. When you take this off, it's another big open hole there. So you can take like a moist paper towel, jam it down in there, dry it all off. You can take a dry paper towel, put it all in there, dry it all off. I would avoid like running this under the sink or just like haphazardly running water through this. Once I started the process, it was actually pretty easy to clean. I put my deck back on, I re-wicked it, I filled it up with juice, and we're good to go. I really like this vape. I really like the quality of vape that I get from this. I just wish the mod wasn't so ugly. Clicking over to Heaven's Gifts, where this one came from, $80. $80 will get you the iJoy RDTA box full kit. If you love RDTAs and you love iJoy and you love vaping with Twisted 420, this is probably exactly what you're looking for. Dual 18650, plenty of power, all the temperature control modes. You can set your preheat. You can build some nice big fused Claptons on this Velocity style deck. It's nice and easy to wick, and it's got a freaking 12 mil tank. A freaking 12 mil tank. That's awesome. And you can see right here how much juice you have. You just go, okay, wobble it back and forth. You can see your kind of juice level moving in there. And when you press the button, these light up. Really enjoyed my time with the RDTA box. I think it's a really great vape. Vape budget hands, maybe. $80, sure, but you're getting a mod and a deck, and it's an RDTA, and it's everything you need in one. All you're gonna need after this is batteries, building materials, and juice. You don't have to buy a separate RDA and a separate mod. You're gonna be using this all together all the time. It has plenty of airflow options. You can close it way down for restricted lung hit. You can open it way up for almost no resistance, just pure clouds, bro clouds. If we're gonna play the FDA game or the aliens game where they come and take all of my vape gear, is the iJoy RDTA box something I would seek out and buy? Probably not. It's not gonna be really high on my list. A, I think it's ugly. I don't like the way it looks, and that's just purely my opinion. I don't like the way it looks. B, I'm not huge into RDTAs. This one has been working really well, but if I have a choice between a dripper and an RDTA, I'm gonna choose the dripper. If I have a choice between an RTA and an RDTA, I'm gonna choose the RTA. If I have a choice between like a sub-ohm tank or an RDTA, I'm probably gonna choose the sub-ohm tank. RDTA is kind of lowest on my list of vape things that I like, but keep in mind, that is my opinion. If you love RDTAs, then this is probably gonna be pretty high on your list of, hey, I might take a look at that over there. So my final rating is, I don't know, it's not gonna get a banana sticker because I reserve those for things that are really fantastic, but it's gonna definitely get a pretty solid thumbs up. It's just not something that I would personally buy. It doesn't suit my vaping style really well. And also, I'm sorry. I think this is just ugly. But yeah, there you go. RDTA box, you are leaving us. Sayonara, farewell. Glad to have you around. That means something else will be joining the queue on the next Tuesday Bro Tuesday. And that's going to wrap up that vape stuff. So right now, let's do some real quick getting to know Grim Green. So, I asked people for video messages, which I happen to really like. I feel like everybody has a smartphone now, so if you have a video message, maybe getting to know Grim Green, just send it on over to nick@grimgreen.com and it might end up on the show. But I got a video here from this guy.
Hey Grim, what's going on? Kenny with New England Vapors out here in Massachusetts. Want to ask you a quick question about your getting to know Grim Green. When was it that you got into craft beers? Because back when I was 19 years old, I'm 22 now, and I started first watching your videos, you got me really into the idea of trying, you know, craft beers or beers with actual flavor. And really, you turned a whole new leaf with me, and now all I drink is a lot of craft beers, Guinness, etc. So, just a quick question, figured I'd ask, and have a great day, man. Peace.
Kenny, that is a fantastic question. Believe it or not, I used to really, really dislike beer, and I think I used to really, really dislike beer because I hadn't really had a good beer that I wanted to enjoy. Of course, in high school, I don't condone underage drinking in any capacity. But, you know, in high school, after high school, you drink shit. You drink whatever you can get. And whenever I could get was like Tecate, PBR, just meh, just beer that I wasn't into it. I just didn't like it. And so I just didn't drink beer. Even when I turned 21, all through most of my 20s, I just didn't drink beer. I just didn't like it. It didn't appeal to me because I had a preconceived notion in my head of what that beer would taste like. It wasn't until I started working in the tasting room at Starbucks. So once upon a time, I worked as a coffee taster in the Carson Valley roasting plant, and my boss, Doug, it was just me and my boss, Doug, and we were the coffee tasters for the whole plant, and it was hands down one of the greatest jobs I've ever had. And my boss, Doug, he was a super cool guy, and we were talking about like cocktails and booze and rum and this and that and the other, and he's like, do you drink a lot of beer? And I was like, no, you know, I don't really drink a lot of beer. I just haven't really been into it. He's like, oh, you should try some of this, that, and the other. And he gave me a couple beers to try. He said, just go try these. I think you might be into them. Like, I liked Guinness, kind of, but that was just because I feel like I was supposed to like Guinness. Like, you talk to a beer guy, you know, you talk to any guy, like, oh, Guinness is the beer of beers. It's the best beer of all time. And so I was like, I kind of like Guinness. So I went to the store right that day, and this was in the wintertime, and I bought a 4-pack of Old Rasputin's Russian Imperial Stout, just as a let's give beer a second chance. And it changed my life, man. It flipped my world upside down. Old Rasputin's Russian Imperial Stout was the first like really intricate craft beer that I ever tried, and I absolutely fell in love with it. It was like drinking a meal. It was so thick and heavy and rich and full of flavor, and it was the polar opposite of drinking something like Miller Genuine Draft, you know what I mean? And that was it. That first beer, Old Rasputin's Russian Imperial Stout, I went back to work the next day and I was like, Doug, I tried that Russian Imperial Stout and it was amazing. What else should I drink? So he gave me some more beers to try. I just started getting into it on my own. I became a huge fan of like Beer Advocate and beer forums. And I was like reading about these rare beers that I wanted to try. And I was trying to like figure out what types of beer I liked. And I tried a bunch of IPAs and realized I don't really like IPAs, and that's okay. And I tried a bunch of, you know, stouts and imperial stouts and Belgians and Belgian triples and Belgian quads. And, you know, you kind of start tasting different beers and you kind of get your palate down. Like, what do you really like out of a beer? And then you gravitate towards those beers. And I found myself really enjoying like Belgian beers. Hoegaarden was one of the first beers that I really fell in love with as well. Just thought it was super delicious. I started getting into Belgian triples and quads. That's right around the time I discovered Guldendrak, which is to this day one of my favorite beers of all time. Things like the St. Bernardist ABT 12. And so I started reading about these beers, these great beers. And then when I became a roaster at Starbucks, I met Meat. I met my buddy Brandon, whom we call Meat, and literally every night we would just talk about beer. Like, just talking about beer. Like, oh, have you tried this? No. Oh, have you tried this? No. Oh, have you tried this? No. And he helped me move one time. When I was moving from Carson City to Dayton, he helped me move, and he brought like a six pack of Samuel Smith Chocolate Organic Stout, and oh man, I just fell in love. Like, he turned me on to so many beers. He exposed me to so many great beers that between Doug and Meat, I was completely turned around on the world of beer. I instantly fell in love with it because it was so rich, so diverse, so many different types of beer. And you know, when you start getting into like yeasts and malts and hops and how that can affect the flavor, it's just great. It's a whole fun world of beer. And you know, every beer isn't gonna, you know, impress you. They can't knock them all out of the park, right? So there's been plenty of beers that I've purchased, like expensive beers that I bought where I'm like, wow, this bottle of beer is $18. I hope it's worth it. Turns out it's not. And you learn from that. You go, oh, okay, maybe I don't like this particular style of beer. Maybe I'm not a huge fan of the wheat beers, or maybe I'm not a huge fan of this. And so you kind of pick and choose. Ultimately, whatever you like is up to you. You know, it's a lot like anything else in the world, food or e-liquids or beer or anything. What you like is up to you. I like Belgian quads. I like darker beers. There's a few IPAs that I do really like, but I tend to gravitate towards Belgian beers, especially Belgian triples and quads. And that's how I got started. I blame my boss, Doug, and I blame shitty high school beer for tarnishing me on beer. But yeah, whole big world of beer out there. If you think you don't like beer, give some of these craft beers another shot. Definitely the what is the one I just said? What's the one I just freaking said? Samuel Smith Organic Chocolate Stout. That will win over anybody. It is so freaking delicious. So freaking delicious. But yeah, that's how I got into beer. Beer. Good times. I miss beer. I think I'm going to have a lunch beer today just because I can. So yeah, let's wrap up that getting to know Grim Green and let's move on to some more vape stuff. So, RX300, yeah, people went bananas last week when I said I was using two different batteries in here, two different sets of batteries. One guy in particular, he got so mad. He's like, that is dangerous. You are going to hurt yourself, you're going to hurt your batteries, and you're going to blow up the world. The RX300 won't let you do anything dangerous. Worst case scenario, absolute worst case scenario that you will get from mismatching batteries in here is that you will shorten the lifespan of your batteries. The mod won't let you do anything dangerous, but to appease everybody, I have a quad set. These are sub-ohm cells, so they're not amazing batteries, but I'm not running anything super low that requires high amperage. I have a quad set of batteries in here. I recently emailed Battery Mooch to get some guidance, to get some advice, to say, hey, people have been telling me this. I want to come to you and see what can be done. Like, what can you do? I'm operating under the assumption that as long as your batteries are two married pairs and they have the same specs, so you're using four 20 amp batteries, sure, if you're using two 20 amp batteries and two 10 amp batteries, that doesn't really matter. Like I said, the mod's not going to let you do anything dangerous. Shut up, Siri. I am not talking to you.
They're not amazing batteries, but I'm not running anything super low that requires high amperage. I have a quad set of batteries in here. I recently emailed Battery Needs to get some guidance to get.
Siri just started listening to me and then repeated back to me everything I just said. Shut up, Siri. You are useless. I don't even remember what I was talking about. Batteries. Yes, if you use two 25 amp batteries and then two like 12 amp batteries. Yeah, I mean, that's that could be bad, but really all you're going to do is shorten the lifespan or possibly damage your batteries. You're not going to blow anything up. Nothing's going to be blowing up. You're not going to damage the mod. You're not going to destroy your atomizer. There's going to be no venting going on. The mod itself won't let you do anything dangerous. I'm actually going to keep this around in the queue until the next Tuesday Bro Tuesday because I really want to hear back from Battery Mooch. I want to get the correct information out there about these batteries. And if I am wrong, yes, I am more than willing to admit when I'm wrong. That's how you learn things. I just want to get the right information out there. Otherwise, RX300's been awesome. It's a big fucking clunky thing. It's just big. It's just big. This is, in my opinion, completely unnecessary. I don't need a mod this big. Maybe if I'm using it at home and I just want to set it on my desk, but I'm not going to put this in my pocket. Like, what? It's big. It's so big. It's hard. You can't appreciate it on video. You have to actually hold it in your hand until you realize, wow, that's pretty big. I like the buttons. I like the display. I actually really like the interface too. Someone gave me some really good advice. What was his name? We're actually going to talk about this when we get to the Altus tank, but a fella named Prescadoli. I'm sorry if I'm butchering your name. Prescole? Anyway, he gave me some good advice about how to get into this menu, how to set it up for custom TCRs, how to set your preheat time and blah, 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 and this, that, and the other. And it's good. It's nice and vertical. Vertical? What? Nice and verse? Hi, talking. Versatile. That's the word I was trying to think of, is freaking versatile. But anyway, I've been enjoying it. We're going to talk about this tank in a second, but I got it topped with the Altus T1. Been a really nice vape. So yeah, RX300, right now, as of right now, it's definitely getting a thumbs up. It's incredibly well constructed. My only gripe with it is it's just big and clunky. Otherwise, everything about it is great. The board is great. The buttons are great. The fit and finish is great. It's just big and clunky. The only reason I'm keeping this around another week is because I do want to get the correct battery information out there. So right now, it's definitely getting a thumbs up. It's not something that I would buy. I'm not attracted to overly gigantic things. I have an old school 44 DNA 200. That's about as big as I would really ever go. And I only like this because it's still pretty narrow and I can put it in my pocket. This quad 18650, there's no way that this is comfortably fitting in anybody's pocket ever. So moving on from there to the Altus. Altus might be hanging around another week with us as well. I've been really enjoying the vape. Let me just say that right away. I've been really enjoying the vape and I've been wanting to get it to work correctly in temperature control mode. And I think I have finally achieved that. Thanks again to Prescole. He gave me some tips about getting the preheat up, and then additionally, David from Altus, he said that I can use it in nickel mode. So I have my preheat temperature set to 80 watts for 2 seconds right off the bat, and then I have it in temperature control mode nickel at 380 degrees. It eliminates that ramp up and it gives me a really super nice vape. Completely eliminates that ramp up. You can just press the button and take a toot. Maybe it was the way that I wicked it, or maybe I accidentally singed the coil when I was running it in regular power mode, but I've already had to re-wick this once since last week, and now it's going on 3 days, and I feel like I need to re-wick it again. I feel like I'm constantly getting like very slightly dry hits. So what I want to do in between this week and next week, or the next Tuesday Bro Tuesday. I'm not going to have a Tuesday Bro Tuesday next week, but between now and the next Tuesday Bro Tuesday is I'm going to re-wick this again, and I'm going to dial in this temperature control so that it works perfectly for me. David also said that I can use this on the Noisy Cricket and turn the variable wattage about halfway, and it'll eliminate that ramp up time as well. Really, I just don't feel like my time is done with this Altus T1. I genuinely want to spend more time with this. It's been a really good vape. The flavor is really nice, but I still don't think I have it dialed in correctly in temperature control mode. And I have been focusing all my energy on getting this temp dialed in. Sometimes I can leave it at 370 degrees and it's a really fantastic vape, but it'll still burn at the end. Like if I take too long of a drag, I can feel my cotton getting burnt or singed. And if I turn it down to like 330 degrees, the temperature control kicks in like right away. So I'm trying to dial in the sweet spot, and maybe this is just like a personal mission, like a personal vendetta, but I want to dial this in perfectly in temperature control mode. And unfortunately, it's just not something I have done just yet. So both of the RX, actually the RX doesn't need to stay around. The RX, you're done. You're leaving the queue. I will update on the next Tuesday, Bro Tuesday, with what I receive back from Mooch regarding proper battery safety for the RX 300. Final judgment on the RX 300. Thumbs up. It's dope. It's a cool ass mod. It's got plenty of battery life. It's got a great fit and finish. The board on it is awesome. It does temperature control. It does great wattage mode. It's just so big and clunky that I never want to leave the house with it. And that's what puts it on my I would never buy this list. But you, Altus T1, you are going to stick around for another week because I am not done dialing you in yet. I'm just not done dialing you in yet. See, that was a thing that just happened. That's 330 degrees and the temperature control kicks in almost instantaneously. But sometimes if I turn it up to like, okay, well that was 330. Let's try 350. Nope, protected. So I feel like I have to turn it up to like 380. But then if I take too long of a drag, the temperature control never kicks in and I get that like acrid burning cotton flavor in my mouth. So Altus T1, you're sticking around another week. Yeah. All right. There we go. Vape stuff stuff. Let's end the vape stuff stuff. Let's do some friggin' viewer mails. All right, so I got a fellow named Josh who wrote to me here and says, "Hey Nick, my name is Josh and I've got some news, but not news, I've got some news, but not news maybe some people may not know. For me, it's more of a gripe. Anyway, I had to get a biometric screen, blood test, body fat percentage, etc. for insurance, and they have to do a cheek swab for smoking. However, this doesn't mean you have been smoking cigarettes. It basically only tests for nicotine. I've been vaping since July, and I haven't even thought about picking up another cigarette. I failed the swab test showing positive for nicotine, but the lady doing my test said even people who use the nicotine gum get a positive reading with this test. It's like insurance companies don't care that we're trying to better ourselves. They want to get all the money they can from us. Obviously, I don't know what ways they could maybe improve these types of tests, but I think they should try to improve it for people who are trying to better themselves. What are your thoughts on this? Also, you can use this in a video if you want. I don't know if it would really count as news, but maybe some people didn't have this information. Thanks, Nick, for your time, and let's keep on vaping, even if they try to hold us down." Yeah, Josh, that's messed up. That's effed in the A. When I did my test for insurance, they just asked if I was a smoker, to which I said no. And then he said, and then I said, "No, I don't smoke. I vape." And the guy said, "Well, there's not a spot for that on here, so I'm just going to mark you as a non-smoker." They didn't swab the inside of my mouth to test for nicotine. I think that is somewhat of a stupid test. If you're testing the inside of someone's cheek for nicotine to see if they're a smoker or not, and there's nicotine in there, and you're not a smoker, but they call you a smoker anyway, then what the fuck? That's stupid. That's stupid. That's really stupid. Yes, I absolutely think there should be, this is something I've always said, vaping needs to be its own thing. It can't be a pharmaceutical thing. It can't be a tobacco thing. It needs to be its own unique thing because it is its own unique thing. Sorry you had to go through that, Josh, and I'm sorry that your insurance company assumes you're a smoker because you had nicotine in your cheek. God, that is so ridiculous. Ah, so Lex writes to me. This was a question that we actually answered on the Culture of Clouds podcast as well, but Lex wrote and said, "Hey Grim, I have bought items from many different online vape vendors. I receive a lot of emails from them. They are always introducing new products. How can this be happening after August 8th? Could you answer this in a video because I know many people who are just as confused as myself. Thank you for everything. Keep on vaping, Lex." Yeah, so after August 8th, there was supposed to be a freeze on the industry. There were many vendors who squeaked out products just before August 8th, and then suddenly they went back out of stock again. And I'm not saying I'm innocent of this, but that is a way that companies have been releasing new products. If you have a paper trail, invoices and sales and marketing and products prior to August 8th, you can then replenish those products anytime you want. And that's what a lot of people are doing. There are also a lot of vendors that just don't give any fucks. They are not playing by the rules in any capacity, and they're just creating and releasing brand new products. Additionally, no one, not even the FDA, is going to be able to hold China accountable. China gives no fucks. They are just cranking out new products after new products after new products. But what happens is if a vape shop starts selling these brand new products in their shop, the vape shop is who is held liable, not the Chinese manufacturers. So the Chinese manufacturers don't care. They're just releasing constantly new products that may or may not be for sale in the United States, that could be for sale, you know, throughout the rest of Europe, throughout the rest of the world. So to answer your question, I don't know what the fuck is going on. A lot of people don't care. A lot of people are playing by the rules. And there is the loophole that if you had product on the market before August 8th, you can sell it after August 8th. So a lot of new products that are going to be coming out this year were probably squeaked, I mean, whisper squeaked onto the market before August 8th, meaning that they have a paper trail, they have invoices, they have sales on record pre-August 8th, and then they won't technically be back in stock until much, much later. I hope that clears it up. Hope that answers your question just a little bit. A fellow named James wrote to me and said, "Hey Nick, how do you feel about big beer companies taking over small breweries all over the United States? Do you still consider them craft beer after they sell out?" Yeah, absolutely. Of course there's still craft beer. Craft beer is the beer. It's not who runs the company. Ballast Point is a good example. They just got bought out by Big Beer, and they're cranking out some of the best beers that I've ever had. And additionally, now that they have that big beer money, they've completely like redone and redeveloped the Ballast Point tasting room down the street, and it's beautiful. It's gorgeous in there now. So small companies being bought by big companies, I mean, fuck, that's capitalism. It's hard to resist being bought out. If an insanely huge vape vendor offered me like a couple cool $1 million for Namber Juice, it would be really hard to pass that up. I mean, there's a lot of companies that I would never sell to, like big tobacco or any tobacco companies, of course not. But larger vape companies buying smaller vape companies, larger breweries buying smaller breweries, I mean, that's the way that capitalism works. There's people who have created apps and websites, and I mean, Facebook bought Instagram and Google bought YouTube. So it's just a thing, the way that it works. I do still consider any small brewery that gets bought by big beer to be a craft brewery. It's the product that's craft. It's not the people making the product, if that makes any sense. So yeah, definitely, James. I hope that answers your question. Let's do one more. Skylar writes to me and says, "Hey Nick, I figured this," the title of his email was Star Wars Bar Maidens. And this has nothing to do with Star Wars Bar Maidens, but he writes to me and says, "Hey Nick, I figured that title would get your attention. LOL. But anyways, I'm super interested at getting a Stabwood box, the M17 particularly, but I'm not at all a fan of LiPo batteries." Why not? LiPos are great. I love LiPo batteries. I really do enjoy dual 18650 regulated devices and was highly considering the Minikin Kodama, but then I saw a few reviewers saying how it had a really bad battery sag as far as the batteries being a little less than halfway drained and the device giving a check battery warning and then it would fire and that would annoy the hell out of me, but your opinion or suggestion would be super appreciated, bro. Thanks again, Skylar. Also, I'd be totally cool with you using my name in this viewer mail segment. That would actually be pretty sick. Yeah, so why don't you like LiPos? LiPos are great. I love using LiPos. Very, very little battery sag, plenty of power, high amp limits. It's great. I love the Minikin Kodama. I think it's a fantastic device. This rule applies to not just the Minikin Kodama, but any device ever that uses 18650s, the better the 18650s you use, the less battery sag you're going to have. That's just the way it is. I was using some very meh batteries in my Sigelli Fu Chai, and I was trying to rock it at 120 watts, and almost fully charged, the batteries were sagging way down, and it would limit my wattage. And as soon as I put good batteries in there, changed. Everything changed. It started firing perfectly, and it was giving me very, very little battery sag. So if you get a Minikin Kodama, just put some really good batteries in it, and you'll avoid the whole battery sag problem. If you're using shit batteries, then yeah, it's going to sag, and it's going to cut down your wattage. But use good batteries. I would take another look again at the Axis Vapes M17. The battery life isn't unbelievable on it, but when the battery is charged, it's going to give you everything you could possibly want. I don't know why you're not a fan of LiPos. I mean, I get it. Some people just don't like LiPo batteries. That's cool. I personally really like LiPo batteries. So anyway, I hope that answers your question. Let's wrap this up. This Tuesday Bro Tuesday is just about run its course. I'm going to finish it off with a little juice tasting. All right, so the juice I have this week is just a friggin' mystery juice. It just showed up. I don't know who sent it. I don't know how they got my address, but it just showed up, and it's called Flaked. I know it's supposed to be flaked, but it's spelled all super wrong. It's spelled Flaked. Flaked. It's a pistachio baklava from Primitive Vapor Company. So I'll track down a link, throw it in the description. Pistachio baklava. When I first smelled it, it kind of smelled a little bit like donut pounder to me. I have a feeling this is going to be a really sweet juice. I actually, even just tasting it like that, I get a little bit of that pistachio flavor. And pistachio, the reason I'm tasting this juice is pistachio isn't a flavor that I generally have ever really vaped at all in vaping. I've never run across a really dope pistachio flavor, and I like pistachio flavors. So I got some flaked, loaded up in the Faro RTA drip tank, whatever, 0.18 at 66 watts. Let's give this Flaked a try. Weird. Wow, that is a really bizarre flavor, man. The pistachio is nice. It's kind of more of a like pistachio pudding flavor than a pistachio baklava. I get some like buttery, crispy notes. I get some pistachio notes. Overall, it's pretty sweet. I feel like they do use some amount of sweetener in here, but it's definitely not overpowering in any capacity. It does give me like this weird tanginess. There's like a weird, like almost like sour creamy tanginess mouthfeel that I get kind of back in the jowls of my mouth. Good. I really like that. I really dig that juice. Never had a really good pistachio, and this is good. Like I said, I get like a crispy, buttery sort of like thin crust on like the top of a pie flavor. A lot of sweetness, a lot of like creamy pistachio-ish pudding flavor to it. Quite nice. Quite nice. Flaked. Primitive Vapor Company. That sounds familiar. I'm going to look them up. I'll find this and I'll link it down in the description below. But yeah, there you go. Flaked. I'm going to continue to vape some flaked and I'm going to sit here and edit some video after I eat lunch. But yeah, we're going to wrap up this Tuesday, bro, Tuesday. Let me take a quick look around the room, make sure I didn't forget anything. I also realized I forgot to mention any of the juices that I was vaping in anything, but don't worry, they will all be linked below of what I've been vaping in the little liquids segment. So yeah, that ends this Tuesday, bro, Tuesday. Thank you so much for joining me again, everybody. There is not going to be a Tuesday, bro, Tuesday video next week, but there will be a review video and there will be a vlog next week. You're always more than welcome to join me here every Thursday and the Grim Army for vlog day. Look at the vlog day graphic right here. Vlog day's fun. We taste beer. We do first impressions. We do a whole bunch of stuff. There's some news and some advocacy and yada yada. And it's just a really good time. It's just a really fantastic program. Don't take it from me, though, but I think it's a really good program. Anyway, enough rambling. Let's wrap this Tuesday, Bro Tuesday up. Thank you so much for watching, everybody. And as always, yeah, right there, flacked. Let's keep on vaping.